turn to 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3. This is Paul, and this is what he says about the last days. Now, and we've been living in the last days since the day of Pentecost. Okay? Last days. But Jesus said you can know the times and the seasons. And we'll look at Matthew 24 also tonight. But when the whole world... How many of you have ever read about the law of exponentiality? Anyone? Or the rule of exponentiality? Exponentiality can be described this way. 2 + 2, okay, let's do something simpler. You probably, how many do we have of insurance agents or people who sell life insurance or annuities? Anyone? Or if you're retired in that field, okay, a few. Right, so if a person starts when they're 24, 25 years old, if they put for 10 years $2,000 away, by the time they get into their mid-30s, if they don't put anything else into that fund, am I using the right, correct? If they don't put anything, but they've got $20,000 saved by the time they get in their early 30s, by the time they've retired, they can have as much as $1 million. Because of exponentiality, interest compounding is tremendous, right? Well, the same thing applies to like anything in life, exponentiality. Jesus called it this, the law of retribution. Whatever you sow, that shall you also reap. If you sow a lot of bad in the world, you're going to reap a lot of bad. It's a matter of time. Well, tonight, we're going to talk about, in a big way, the law of exponentiality right here in 2 Timothy chapter 3. But notice that in the last days, perilous times will come. Sin abounds just like in the days of Noah. It got so bad that God looked down and he repented that he had done this and created mankind and what they had done. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord and his family. And it says his pedigree was pure, untouched, untainted. But in the last days, when it gets so bad that these things will happen exponentially, for men will be lovers of themselves. That means this, men with men, women with women, and whatever they want, they do. Lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the form of godliness but denying its power. From such people turn away, for of this sort are those who creep into households and make captives of gullible women, loaded down with sins, led away by various lusts. Now, what Paul is encouraging and telling young Timothy, his convert and like a son in the faith to him, he's telling him, don't fall for these things and don't let others fall for these things. As a young pastor, I want you to beware of these things. They're going to happen in your day, and he's still writing that to us. It's happening today, the law of exponentiality. The world has been in trouble. The world's been compiling. Sin has been compounding. And now America, it seems, is leading the world in legislative acts we really are legislating immorality. What was considered 10 and 20 years ago very much righteous is now considered stupid and silly, and what was considered unrighteous 10 and 20 years ago is considered to be the thing to do. We're mocked and scoffed at because of what we believe. Oh, those evangelical believers, those Christians, they're far right, they're crazy, they're bigots, haters, despisers of others. They call us names because what we believe in is a book that has not changed, okay? So last time, the law of exponentiality, you look around and sin abounds. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be what? In the coming of the Son of Man. So that's the first text we look at. Then the second text we need to look at is found in Matthew chapter 24. Most of this is concerning the day of the Lord, not the rapture. Some people get really confused, but this might confuse some of you if you're not really read up on end time prophecy. Before the day of the Lord, what has to happen for believers? Before the day of the Lord, or the second advent, the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, what has to happen? Well, the rapture. We're raptured. Some believe we're raptured pre-trib, some believe mid-trib, and some believe, a few, that we're raptured right before the day of the Lord. I don't know how they get that. I understand somewhat mid-trib people, but pre-tribulational, if you understand weddings in the first century, it's pretty hard to get off track and be mid-trib or post-trib. But at any rate, I hope I don't confuse you here. In just a minute, we're going to get real practical, and it'll make a little bit more sense. The rapture is going to occur, and the Bible tells us about the day of the Lord, the second coming, that no man knows the hour or the day. No man knows specifics. In the same chapter, it does tell us that by watching the fig tree, a farmer can know the season. There have been lots of people, the Millerites. How many of you know who Harold Camping is? Harold Camping was a preacher out in California, had a great following, a deep resonating voice. He had people watching for the Lord to return in 2011 like I've not seen Christians watch. I mean, people were selling their homes. This last blood moon, there were a lot of Christians that I know that went all the way to South Carolina to be there, because that was the most avid place in our country to see the blood moon, and they were thinking the Lord's going to rapture. We're not to wait and sit around willing it to happen so much that we're not working. We're to be working while we're waiting, and we're to be anticipatory of His coming again. So tonight is all about this. Matthew chapter 24, verse 3. Now as He, Jesus, sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to Him privately, saying, "Tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age?" That's been the question for mankind, hasn't it? And Jesus answered and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom." That means it's people against people, color against color, kind and creed against kind and creed. The more evolved we become, isn't it crazy? They say education will put down racism, but it doesn't. It seems like in America, you would think that after our first black president that we'd have less racism. There was more racism. Why is it? I'll tell you why. It's not because Christians aren't getting better. It's because sin is alive in our being. We're sinners. And if we don't confront sin in our life, it becomes exposed, and it just amplifies itself, and it expounds on itself, and exponentially it grows, and hate abounds. And remember 2 Timothy 3. This is going to increase before the Lord comes again, before the end of time. So wars and rumors of wars, see that you're not troubled. All these things must come to pass, but the end's not yet. Nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, there will be famines and pestilences, earthquakes in various places. All these are the what? Beginning of sorrows. Now, there's not conclusive evidence that Jesus is teaching about pre-rapture or after the rapture here. But He is teaching this. These things must happen before the second coming. And remember, the rapture occurs. Those of us who are pre-trib would say the rapture occurs, and 7 years immediately start right then. Okay? That's called pre-trib. pre-tribulation. People believe the rapture occurs, and then 3.5 years of tribulation, and 3.5 years of great tribulation, the Bible tells us. We'll explain that a little bit better in a few minutes. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. Now, who, by the way, is he speaking to? Who's his audience here? Jewish people, but specifically his disciples. Last I checked, last we went through, and we're down to just Paul now, but they were all Jewish men. He's speaking to them as Jews. Some here might be Calvinists, and all Calvinists like to say, oh, Romans 9 and 10, those two chapters, they address Calvinism and see the Bible's clear about Calvinism. No, Romans 9 and 10 is not at all about Calvinism. Romans 9 and 10 is about nationality. It's not your individual salvation that Paul's talking. He's talking about the nation of Israel, how Christ will come and bring them back to him, how they are his elect, and he will prove himself to them. So then many, verse 11, then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many, and because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. Watch this now. Verses 15 and following, very specific. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, some of you are going to be confused. The abomination of desolation, right? Watch this now. The rapture occurs. Rapture means snatching up or the taking out, the bringing up of Christians. The church, the bride of Christ, will be raptured. And it talks about that in Thessalonians, talks about that in John chapter 14. There's all through Revelation, these things are discussed and at length gone into. So the rapture occurs, and right away it says in 2 Thessalonians, listen real carefully right now to me. If you have heard the gospel, and you have doubted your salvation, or you've had this spiritual experience in your life, but for years you've gone in and out of church, and a love affair with the Lord, and a love affair with the world, and there's no fruit in your life, and you know it. If the rapture occurred right now tonight, you wonder if you'd go up. A real funny story, I think I might have told you this before, but I played a joke on Gina years ago when we were in Ringgold, and the girls were little girls with me, and I got them in the hall bathroom with me, and my car was in the garage, so Gina knew I was at home, and she knew the girls were home from school, and I thought we'd jump out and scare her. This morning, I jumped out from underneath Teresa Harris's desk and scared her. Her heart was pitter-pattering like it was when she used to be in love with, well, she fell in love with Milton. Her heart about failed her today. It was funny. But I thought I'd do that to Gina. So I'm in the bathroom with the girls, and we're getting ready. Gina comes in, and I hear her talking to herself, putting away the groceries. And she comes in, and I'm just waiting for her to pass by so we could jump up. Boom! But I hear her crying on the steps, going upstairs. I'm thinking she must have wrecked the car. She drives like a maniac, so she could have. And so I go out and I'm like, what are you doing? This is a true story. This is a preacher's wife. She was sitting on the steps weeping. Steve, I haven't told you this, but for years I've doubted. You've doubted what? My salvation. Well, why haven't you done anything about it? Because I'm embarrassed. I'm the pastor's wife. I've got fruit, but I've never said the prayer. What do you mean never said the prayer? Well, I meant it in my heart, but Romans 10, 9, 10, if you confess with your lips, with your mouth, the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart. I never said it. Semantics, you might think. Hey, she doubted. She's sitting on the steps weeping because she thought, she walked in the house, she knows my car was there, the girls are there, they're not going to go along with their dad playing a joke, trying to scare the mom, no way. So she thought the rapture had occurred, God took the little ones, God took me, because you all know I'm saved. And she thought, he's left me behind. Now listen, if you're left behind, you might think, well, I'll get a second chance. In 2 Thessalonians it says, such strong delusion will be given those who have rejected the gospel. You'll not have that second chance. Oh, God's gracious. He's more gracious than you think, Pastor. Yes, he is. But he's also just. And you've had a chance. She thought she had lost it. Those two letters to Thessalonica, those people thought they were left behind too. They thought that the tribulation had occurred. And they were living in it. They thought they'd missed it. At the end of the service tonight, I'm going to give you a chance. I still haven't yet got to the news. So that's just crazy how someone who knows it. So that Easter Sunday, that was right before Easter, that Easter Sunday, here comes my wife down the aisles. Crazy irony, but hey, whether you're the pastor's wife, whether you're the pastor, none of us measure up to Christ. We all fall short. Amen? All of us. So if you doubt it, you better get it right with God. What verse was I in? Okay, verse 15. When you see the abomination of desolation at the 3.5 year mark. So on the scene, the rapture occurs. All of a sudden, this world leader comes onto the scene. He's an awesome leader. Everyone's like, well, he's handsome. He's eloquent. He's golden-tongued. He's smart. He's wise. He's young. He's powerful. He's charismatic. Signs and wonders follow him, which means he's able to do miracles. And he's got this lie. I don't know if it's, spaceship came down and aliens took all these people. Think of this. Every child below the age of accountability from every nation of the world, every baby in every crib, snatched away. Gone. People will be in shock. Like some folks in this room who have lost a child, can you imagine your baby that you gave birth to, especially if you were unable to have babies, children, or you adopted and then they're gone? Can you imagine? Can you imagine the trains, the planes, the automobile wreck, the financial markets of the world, how they're going to come crashing? People are going to be in shock, and this Antichrist is going to come on the scene, and he's going to be so eloquent, the whole world turns to him, and now we all have phones. Bill and Melinda Gates are trying desperately to inoculate, to give shots, to educate, to get agriculture to the poorest of people on the other side. And they've got the money to do it. And there's one other thing that they want to do. They want to give a cell phone, a smartphone, to every person in the world so that they can get educated. That makes it possible that all nations in their tongue can hear the gospel. We didn't have that possibility just 3-5 years ago. We're living in exciting days. I mean, it's right here on us. So all these things happen and people are shocked and they don't know what they're going to do. And this eloquent world leader steps on the scene and everyone immediately trusts in him. And he brings Jews, Christians, and Muslims together to the table. And they sign a peace treaty. And everyone's happy. And a temple is rebuilt that inhabits, I believe, Muslims, Christians, and Jewish people right there in the holy site in Jerusalem. And everyone's happy. And the temple's been rebuilt. And at the 3.5 year mark, he goes into the temple. And guess what he says? I'm the Christ. I'm the Messiah. Worship me. And this pact with Israel, she's done away with. Let's annihilate her. And the great tribulation rises up. Now, Israel's getting it through the first 3.5 years, but they begin to get it like the world has never seen before. All these things must be, Jesus taught his disciples, Jewish men, but don't be troubled. It's not upon us. So he goes on, spoken by Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place. Whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let him who is on the housetop not go down to take anything out of his house. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes. But woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing babies in those days. Pray that your flight may not be in winter or on the Sabbath, for then there will be great tribulation, such as not been since the beginning of the world until this time. Can you imagine that? Think of all the pestilences. Think of all the infanticide. The Jews at Hitler and Stalin's hands. Nothing is going to be like this. Jesus is telling them, and they're worried. And unless once those days were shortened, or it's not saying that the 24-hour time period is short, he's saying unless it was just a short period of time. Unless the days were shortened, no flesh would be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. Then if anyone says to you, look, here's the Christ or there, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. See, I have told you beforehand. Therefore, if they say to you, look, he is in the desert, do not go out. Look, he's in the inner rooms, do not believe it. For as in the lightning comes from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the Son of Man, will the coming of the Son of Man be. Forever the carcass is, there the eagles will be gathered together. So we have that truth spelled out to us by Jesus. You're saying, Pastor, what's got you so riled up about end times? Well, when I got up at 3 o'clock in the morning and I heard Donald Trump say, or I read the news, that he was going to be announcing today that Israel, that the United States was going to move our embassy to Jerusalem. And listen, it's going to take 3 to 4 years. Our government can pay contractors to go over there and build that building in 6 to 8 months. Why is it going to take 3 to 4 years? Well, you got to move things around. You got to give time for the Arabs, the Christians, the Orthodox people, for them to all sit at a table and for us to negotiate. You got to schmooze people over. There's things that have to be done. Communication lines and security things that have to be done. And man, you got to feel this out careful. But we like to think in human terms. God just sits up in heaven in his throne and says, you think you're moving at your time, but you're on my time. Amen. Remember, I told you, according to all of our past 4 presidents, 3 to 4 years. And that started in 1995. Now, legislation was passed by both parties in 1995, overwhelmingly passed for Jerusalem to be the capital city of Israel. It makes sense. It just makes sense. It's their land. Now, you say, well, how did it become their land? They lost it for 2,000 years. You remember? You got the Old Testament. For 70 years, they went into Babylonian captivity, right? Y'all know about that. The book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah was this prophet, and he's preaching and teaching to them, saying if you don't come back to God's commandments, both Israel and Judah is going to be captive and taken away. Israel, the top 10 tribes, they'd already had civil war. They didn't listen. They didn't care. They didn't even have a good king. And they were quickly snatched up, taken away, killed, murdered, raped, burned up, knocked down. Everything's gone in Israel. And yet Judah, this smaller tribe, they had, out of the 18 kings that they had 8 decent ones, good ones, and now they're down to nothing but bad. And Jeremiah was like, the same thing that happened to Israel is going to happen to us. They didn't listen. So for the third time, Babylonian captivity came. The king came into town. He raised the walls. He knocked down every part of Solomon's beautiful temple, knocked it to the ground, burned the stones. They said if even a fox goes up on the walls of it, he'll knock it down. And then they just took a few, they killed, they raped, they tortured, but they took some of the royal family, Daniel, Hananiah, Azariah, Mishael. Those are part of thousands of the royal family and kids they took out of the best schools of Israel and Judah, and they took them to Babylon. And there they stayed for 70 years. And then Nehemiah, a cupbearer, is being led by God to come out. And he goes and he takes this journey, and he goes into Jerusalem, and he weeps and cries because he sees the gates and the walls and the temple and all of their homes. What if you came to Aniston and Oxford and Alexandria and all the surrounding region and everything was there? What if we left here tonight and a gas line exploded in our church and it knocked it to the ground? I've had that happen before in church life. People come to the church, they just look and cry. When you've been robbed at your house, You, of course, you call a company to come and put security on your home. You might get an extra gun or two, or get a first gun. You do a lot of things, but then you lie down in your bed and you feel like someone has taken something, and you don't trust the same place. If everything about your hometown, if everything about Temple, if everything about everyone and people that you knew had died, now you're back and there's Nehemiah, a cupbearer of a king, just an average person serving in the government. He's looking at the city and just weeping and praying, and he goes into a fast, and he's like, God, use me. And what, two times others had gone back to Jerusalem to reestablish on their own. They couldn't do it. Unsuccessful for years. God led Nehemiah back in 52 days. Those walls were rebuilt like they'd never been dropped down. God, when God leads something, the people of God move. And when people of God come together and have a mind to work, as it says in the book of Nehemiah, man, those walls rose up. So let me get back on track here. This is the crazy thing about what happened to them. After the 70 years of captivity, the people came back. They restored worship. Zerubbabel rebuilt the temple. And then in Jesus' day, right before Jesus, years before Jesus, there's this guy named Herod. And man, Zerubbabel's temple was nice, but he wanted to restore the old temple. So he started taking it down, and he refurbished and remodeled and did it like it should have been done when Solomon had built it. He wanted it to be like Solomon's temple, so he rebuilt it. And Jesus is walking through Jerusalem one day, and he says to his disciples, this is going to be knocked down. 3 days later, it's going to be rebuilt. They're like, if you've ever been to Israel, specifically to Jerusalem, and you've seen the Western Wall, the Wailing Wall, some of the some of Herod's temple, rebuilt temple, you say, there's no way you could knock this down 3 days later, rebuild this. There's just, come on, you're crazy. He wasn't talking about that temple, was he? He was talking about him. But then he tells them later, this temple will be destroyed. And guess what happened? 70 AD, it was totally, completely annihilated. And it has not stood again. But you can still go and see portions of it today as it was when Herod rebuilt a portion of it. Wailing Wall is still there. And Israel owns it. They've indeed entitled it. And in fact, on May 14th, this is where it gets practical, on May 14th of 1948, Great Britain came to America and said, we got to do the right thing by the Jewish people. The whole world is just, look what the world's done. Look what we've done to Israel and Jewish people. It's time that we help them to reestablish themselves, and we give them this land. So they deeded it back. Just two countries led the world to deed it back. Muslims hated it. But they owned the city of Jerusalem. But the Palestinians, anyone know who the real Palestinians are? The Palestinians of the 21st century are none other than the Philistines of David's days. How do you like that? And if you trace their lineage, go back and back, they're, of course, Arabs. They hate the children of Israel because Jacob I've loved. What? Esau I've hated. Why? Because of deeds and the heart. And one, I mean, Jacob was blessed. And Esau, man, look what happened in his life because his heart, his choices in life. So now today, Trump says we're going to move our embassy to Jerusalem. And we're going to do this. No other president in the last four presidents have done this. All the way back to Bill Clinton, they did it. And every 6 months, they sign a waiver saying, we're going to do it in 6 months. And then 6 months later, we're going to do it in 6 months. Why? Because the world takes the pulse of the American people and the American president. And the world's saying, if they do it, other nations are going to follow suit. And they've been putting pressure on us. If you do this, we're going to wipe those people of Jerusalem right. We'll go to war against them. Well, they've been warring against them anyways. Every president since Bill Clinton has promised the Jewish people that they were going to go and move the American embassy to Jerusalem, but not one president has made the announcement. Why? Well, because a world war could break out. Nuclear holocaust could occur again. And we keep saying, well, let the Palestinians sit down with the Jews at the table. Let's get them to sit down. Remember Jimmy Carter? His best thing that he did in office was getting the people of Egypt, their leader, to sit down with the prime minister of Israel and have a peace pact. And about 4 months after that peace pact, the Egyptian leader was suddenly, he died. And Egypt was happy because he brokered a deal with the hated Jews. Now they followed through on that pact, but no Arab really wants to have peace with Israel. They hate them. You know why? Well, they think they took away their land. But the real reason why is because God is against his people because they forsook him. And Jeremiah said, if you forsake him, he will forsake you. And you don't want to make God mad. Don't do this, Israel. They didn't listen. Don't do this, Judah. They didn't listen. They've been suffering ever since they rejected him. And they said to him when he came into that city on the mule, on that donkey, they said, oh, hail him, king of the Jews. And then just less than a week later, crucify him, fickle people led by horrible leadership. And they just always, remember what Elijah said on the mount? How long will you waver between the gods? Choose today Yahweh. Israel wouldn't. They have always forsaken him. And he's like, well, you've not kept your side. Have you done the same thing that Israel's done? Have you forsaken him? Though you know he loves you, though you know he's gracious and died on the cross for you, you can't look at Israel and say, that's stupid on their part. He blessed them if they came to him. Well, yeah, he blessed you if you came to him. Oh, I've seen some of the Christians. They go through the same thing I do. Yeah, but theirs called an eternal home and eternal rewards to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away. It's reserved in heaven, not for his son, but for all of the inheritance of his son's estate. He wants to share it with you. That's a blessing that you can't miss. So now we're moving this embassy back to Israel, and all the world, all the Arabs are so mad. Why is it, let me get to this and be done somewhat, why is it that they're so mad? And what's so good to know about this? Listen, today when I heard this, I was like, wow, they're coming right out. They're coming right out and saying, I don't give timelines. I don't put dates on when the Lord's going to rapture his church. But let me give you a little heads up. I believe that God loves numbers. He's big into numerology. He really is. And let me give you a few numbers that you can write down in your worksheet. He's interested in the number 3. You all know that. Father, Son, Holy Ghost. He's also into 3 inner disciples, Peter, James, and John. There were 3 men standing with him when he was on the Mount of Transfiguration. He uses 3 all through the New Testament. He did even in the Old Testament. Christ prayed 3 times in the garden. Satan tempted Christ 3 times. 3 gifts were given to Christ by not 3 wise men, but by the wise men. Christ ministered for 3 years. He arose on the 3rd day. Peter denied him 3 times. Christ said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. He likes 3s. And then, if you would, Paul went with no sight for 3 days. And 3 angels visited Abraham. Christ raised up 3 in the New Testament. Lazarus, the widow of Nain's son, and Jairus' daughter. 2 witnesses will die in Jerusalem. Their bodies will lay in state on the streets of the city while the whole world celebrates. This is in the book of Revelation. The whole world celebrates these 2 witnesses. They're sick and tired of hearing judgment, judgment, judgment. So when these 2 guys die, they're killed, they're slain in the streets, they're the world leaders and the world is celebrating. Do you know how the world knows about these 2 witnesses dying? Because someone comes over the top and takes a snapshot with their iPhone or their smartphone and sends it out, and it goes to everyone, to all the world, and the whole world is celebrating. And then on the third day, these two witnesses raise up, and they're like, uh-oh. So God's into three. God's also into seven, the number seven, the number of completion or perfection. Seven is used 735 times in the Bible. It's the foundational number of God's word. There are seven sections to the word of God. There's the law, there's the prophets, there's the writings of poetry, there's the gospel and the books of Acts. There's the epistles, the general epistles. There's the epistles of Paul and the book of Revelation. Seven different sections of our Bible. And then according to Jewish calendar and tradition, Adam was created on September 26, 3700 BC. We know that because the Bible tells us that he was born on the first day of Tishri, the seventh month of the Hebrew calendar. 7 days Noah and his family were in the ark before the flood. There's seven churches in Revelation. There's seven angels talked about in Revelation. There's seven seals, seven trumpets, seven thunders, seven last plagues, seven holy days. God loves the number 12. 12 was used in our Bible 187 times. 12 is the number of governmental foundations. 12 tribes of Israel, there's 12 apostles. There's 12 months of the year. I shocked you with that trivia there. There are 144,000 Jews. Whenever you have a Jehovah's Witness come to your door, make sure you invite them in. Don't send them on their way. They usually come in pairs. You want to bring them in your home, and this is what you want to do. There's a mentor. You're not going to convince him, but then there's the mentee. And this is what you want to do. I'm so glad you're using the Holy Bible, King James Version, right? And they'll say, yeah, because they don't want to tell you the truth. They're not. It's their edition of it. But they'll say yes to you because they want to trick you, deceive you in. And you say, I'm so glad I use the same Bible. Yeah, yeah. And what's amazing is I am totally in agreement with you, and I understand why you're out witnessing. You're trying to be one of the 144,000. That's great. It's awesome. I want to help you in that. Which tribe of Israel do you belong to? Do you really think you'll be in the 144? Isn't there like a million Jehovah Witnesses alive right now? What do you think makes you better than the next guy? You think this mentor who's been doing this a lot longer than you? Right now, what you want to do is get that mentee question the fact, uh-oh, that book has the answers. Even their deluded, dissipated Bible, if they dig into the pages of their Bible, will tell them they believe a lie. And you know what else will speak to them? The power of the Holy Spirit of God. There's 144,000 Jews, 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes. Watch this now. 12,000 from each of the 12. 12 gates in New Jerusalem. The walls of Jerusalem walls are 144 cubit high. City is 12,000 furlongs long. Jesus was 12 when his mother said, oh, I've lost God. We left him. And they went back to Jerusalem. Where did they find the lost son of God? In the temple. Teaching what? With authority. He was just 12. 12 is a number. 70 is a number. God loves 70. There's 70 elders of Israel that Moses led. There's 70 elders of the Sanhedrin. There's 70 disciples that were sent out by Christ in Luke 10. There's 70 weeks of Daniel that I didn't get to tonight. We'll get to them next week. And that is a fascinating, fascinating, eye-opening. Did you know that Daniel pinpointed the day that Jesus Christ would die? The very day, back 2,520 years before it ever happened, he pinpointed the day. 70 weeks of Daniel, there's 70 years of captivity for Israel and Judah that was prophesied. Now watch this. Watch. This is exciting. This is where I'm going to tempt you a little bit to come back next week. May 14th, 1948. Remember, God loves numbers. Now, I'm not dating anything, but I'm saying there's nothing prophetically that needs to happen for the rapture to occur. Nothing. Everything that he gave us It's all pointing to the second coming of Christ. Not all those things have been totally fulfilled. There's just a few things that need to happen, like the Antichrist has to come on the scene. But the large majority of Bible scholars believe that happens after the rapture. So that hasn't happened. The Antichrist hasn't come onto the scene. I read Time magazine every month. This guy, are you ready for this? He's 39 years old. He married a woman 24 years his senior. He is a prolific leader of France. His wife is 24 years older than him. He has absolutely no morals. She was his drama teacher when he was a 16-year-old in high school. They fell in love then. She divorced her husband and married him. And he says he doesn't care what the people of France or the people of the world think. He hated Donald Trump, and Donald Trump hated him. They get together. They're best buds now. Merkel from Germany hated him, never thought he'd be elected. She got in his presence and all of a sudden she likes the guy. You know what his name is? Emmanuel Macron. Isn't that amazing? And the Bible tells us this leader, this Antichrist, comes out of the reestablished Roman Empire, right? That's called, in our day and age, the European Union. Guess what he wants to do? He knows that Great Britain's out, but he wants to unite the European Union, hundreds of millions of people. I'm not saying he's the Antichrist, because Jesus said there'll be many Antichrists before the Antichrist comes out. We've seen many Antichrists. Hitler was supposed to be the Antichrist. You know, Stalin was supposed to be the Antichrist. Arnold Schwarzenegger was the Antichrist. You know, Hillary Clinton was the whore of Babylon. All of these things that we do, I'm being serious with you. You get online, people write this thing. Lots of people are saying, his name is Emmanuel, God with us. Maybe he's the one. We shouldn't be trying to name the persons or name the day. We should be looking, but watch now. We're moving our embassy to Jerusalem, and the whole world's mad right now at us. Could be a negotiating tactic by Donald Trump, but also 3 to 4 years it takes to do this. Guess how long it is before in the Great Tribulation, when the Great Tribulation starts? I mean, it's 3.5. Between 3 and 4 is a half. And it's going to take 3 to 4. And guess what? We're going to celebrate May 14th in just a few months, 5 months. It's going to be the 70th year anniversary of Israel as a state. Right. Phenomenal. Yeah. The time is short. I didn't even get into how he says, hey, you can watch the fig tree and a farmer by watching it. He knows when the season and the leaves are falling off the tree, he's not going to see produce. But he also knows when he's planted, he's watered, he's fertilized, and he can see the fruit on the tree. He can see the figs. He knows soon he's going to have some figs. You can know the season. Now, you need to go online. You need to read. You need to catch up. This is an amazing day for us to celebrate. So all of us need to be concerned and worried about where we're at. Are you ready? I mean, we're on it. The time is ticking in Israel is the clock. And it's 11:59 and some seconds. And the clock is ticking. It's ticking. It's ticking. These things are good news for believers. Good news for believers. And there's really nothing for us to worry about. The Lord says, John 14, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I wouldn't have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. And, oh Lord, we don't know where you're going. Tell us where you're going. We don't know the way. Thomas, come on. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. That's not the Baptist way. That's God's way. Do you know God's way? Have you accepted God's way? Are you a part of the way? God works in numbers, and maybe there's one more that he needs to work in tonight. And maybe that one is you. Maybe there's 10 in here that need to say, man, Steve, like Gina, I've been a deacon I'm the wife of a prominent leader in this church. I teach Sunday school. I sing solos. I've been in church work. I've been a pastor. I'm a deacon. I'm a leader in this church. I've been a leader. But you doubt it. And even a silly joke makes you say, oh my goodness, am I really ready? Lord, today's news.